My guest for Match of My Life today is a military veteran, a former rifleman, Paul Jacobs. He was blinded after an IED explosion in Afghanistan and was later awarded the Georgia Medal for his actions to save other lives. He lives in Wirral. And let's say good morning to Paul. How are you, Paul?
Let me swallow. Good morning.
He's got a cup of coffee, which he's steadily dispatching at the moment.
It's not too bad, actually.
You've got a phenomenal story. You're only 29 years old, but your story is just remarkable. Give us an idea. I mean, you're obviously not from Wirral, are you?
Not the way I talk, no.
No.
It's all Labrador and Pears.
Where's your place of birth?
Southeast London.
Southeast London.
Brixton.
Brixton. Mm. But you've somehow ended up living in Wirral and enjoying life over there now.
It was a woman.
Yeah.
Sorry about that.
No, that's absolutely fine. Let's get into your story and your association with the armed forces. At what age did you join the armed forces?
17.
And why?
Well, I was pretty much homeless and life was not going too well. I come from foster care and children's home, so I was placed in care at the age of one, I think it was, or zero, or whatever. I've got five siblings, all by the same mother and father. The old man did a bit of time away for whatever. The mother couldn't handle it with five kids. And then by the time I was 12, I was being thrown around the country in different foster homes and children's homes. And then when I was in secondary school, my brother died in prison. And then by the time I'd got into the army, my father had died. And then in between that, my sister was multiply raped by a gang in London. And just life was just hard. You know what I mean? It was a fight. And I fight the fight now. So
life couldn't have been much worse as a youngster for you.
No, not really, no. But, you know, little acorns grow into mighty oak trees, don't they? And then people that tried to hurt me, then they couldn't hurt me now, you know what I mean? Because the pen is mightier than the sword.
Well, what was it about the army that was an attraction for you as a young man?
You want the honest answer?
Yeah.
I thought it was the uniform and the women. I mean, it was easier.
So it wasn't the escapism from all the little things bit, that were going on?
Yeah, a little bit was regarding that, you know, I could get away from where I was in Brixton, get away from the hustle, the bustle. And, you know, like a lot of people understand in the cities, you know, there's money to be made on the streets. Sometimes it's legal, sometimes it's illegal. And when you've got nothing, you're bare towards the bad. And I just didn't want that for myself. I wanted to be better. I see where my brother was and he ended up in a box. So he ended up going in prison and then coming out in a box. So did I really want that life for myself and seeing my old man do the same thing? So not really.
Was there a danger that you could have followed a similar path?
I'm an angel.
You are now. could you see yourself being drawn into the wrong areas as a young man?
It was very much on the cards. I'd been arrested a number of times and it was luckily enough that down in Camberwell court, the magistrate just said, go do something with your life, boy, and that just sort of stuck in my head. And then I was over, where was I, Trafalgar Square. I was sitting there, you know, reading the paper, smoking. It was a beautiful day. And I see the soldier march past, couldn't tell you what regiment or whatever, but, you know, he looked dead smart. And his skin looked fresh, do you know what I mean? And I just thought, wow, there's something about that. The way he's walking with confidence and pride and everything. And I thought, yeah, I'm having a bit of that. I sort of stalked him up the road a bit, you know. And I went into the recruiting office and I just said to the fella straight behind the desk, I said, I don't know what rank you are, but I'm going to call you sir just out of respect. And this is my life. And if I go back out there and you don't help me today, I'm going to end up in prison. And I don't want that. Yeah, I can be of a good assistance to you in the armed forces. So, you know what I mean? And his name was Colour Sergeant Nicholas. That was back in whenever it was, 2006 or whenever. And
so you had a divine moment almost. Is it clear as day, well, still to you?
Yeah, absolutely. But it's a bit weird, though. I should have joined the Royal Navy, really, shouldn't I? Being under Nelson's column. So,
but it was a sudden moment of realisation.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. And he said, what do you want to do? Do you know, do your Barb's test, British Army recruiting board. You do your test, you know, see what regiments you want to go in, la, 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 and how much intelligence you got. But for me, it was always the rifles. Respect, independence, friends, learning, excitement, success. The infantry regiments are not too different. You know, you've got Mercians here, which I'm a big fan of the Mercian regiment here in Liverpool. I served with them out in Afghanistan.
Do you think you have the natural mindset for someone to be in the military, given what you've just said about your upbringing and the problems that went around your family as well? Do you think you had to train yourself, divert yourself to get that military mindset?
Well, the infantry, if you look back in time in history, the infantry is made up of criminals that come from prison anyway, because they're thinking men, aren't they? You know, if you take a criminal back in the 18th century who's a robber or whatever, or a murderer or a bare-knuckle boxer, whatever he is, a fighting man, then you put him in a uniform and you get someone to lead him and show him the way, then what you've got is a unique soldier, haven't you? No matter what cap badge he wears. So I suppose I was given an opportunity inside the army, and I just absolutely loved it. I'd go back.
Was it a culture change, or straight away did you fit in?
It was like a glove, hand in a glove. It was just brilliant. I loved every aspect of it because I didn't have to worry about not being able to go to this part of town or go into that part of town. I didn't have to worry about, you know, being a white man in this part of town. Or do you know what I mean? It was just, I could just be me and I could just get on with everybody, you know what I mean? And I'm quite a bubbly person. I like getting on with everybody. I don't care where you're from as long as you're nice to me.
you speak quite honestly about your brother and your father. Do you think life could have been different for them if they'd have made a different choice?
No, I think it's down to the system. Regarding my brother, I think it's down to the system. The system failed my family and many families up and down the whole country. We was all in the system, you know what I mean? And that's obviously down to the father as well, you know what I mean? He was a bit of a donut, obviously. but, you know, it's more in depth, you know what I mean, regarding my brother. You know, there was a lot more to it. Which is why I'm trying to do the opposite now, you know what I mean? I've spent, since losing my sight at the age of 20, I've spent 9 years trying to do the right, you know, raising lots of money for different charities, whether that's veterans, bereaved, rape victims. I'll go out and help anybody, you know what I mean? I absolutely love it. Charity work is a buzz for me. I actually get a proper buzz out of helping people.
You're doing some incredible work out there. We're going to talk about your story in a little bit more depth, including how you came to lose your sight. So tell us a little bit about your tours of duty. Yeah, what was your first tour of duty and what was your expectation?
Well, they call it a tour of duty, but it wasn't really. My first posting was Northern Ireland. That was a buzz. That was a great laugh. The Irish, they know how to party. And it was like, I did my training and I went straight over there. I had a very short career, 5 years all in all, you know. So I went straight from Catterick over to Northern Ireland and it was just a buzz. Everybody over there was just, it was just mad, you know. And then before I knew it, I was then changing my green combats for desert. And it's like getting a bit serious now and I'm thinking, you know, is this what I really want? Did I really sign up for this? And then before you know, you're giving your body arm and you're holding onto your helmet and you're then on a plane and then you're in the sky and then you're landing and you take that deep breath in when you land and yeah, and then you're in Afghanistan and then it's like, this is it. And the thing is that I always remember, I've got no sight at all now, what they call black blind. I always remember where you land at night time in Afghanistan, obviously, for any incoming or whatever. And in the morning, I remember waking up, the sun beaming down on my face, and I'm looking around at these other fellas that have been there, maybe their second or third tour, they've been out there 3 or 4 months prior to what I've been. And you can just see it in their face. It's written, hell, disaster, tiredness, but a sense of pride at the same time. Does that make sense? So, I knew I was in for a bit of a kicking, I think, and I embraced it. I enjoyed my time in Afghanistan.
But a stark contrast to Northern Ireland and the expectations of duty there.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. Do you know what I mean? You're only like 60 minutes flight away from London on a plane or whatever, you know, or you're straight across the ferry. It was just different, you know. You've got real bullets flying over your head and IEDs going off and, you know, 1 minute you're standing next to a fella and the next you want to have dinner with him or play a game of cards with him and he's gone. Do you know what I mean? It's constantly, you know what I mean, filling the ranks. The person behind's filling that space next to you, you know what I mean? So forth, so forth.
We'll talk a little bit about your experiences there in just a moment. My special guest today in Match of My Life is Paul Jacobs, former rifleman. Paul awarded the George Medal for his actions to save others in Afghanistan. Paul, let's pick up the story of you arriving in Afghanistan and what your duty was or what your role was out there at the time. What were you sent out to do?
My job role was to be, I was the front man out of the platoon, so I was a Vallon man, V-A-L-L-O-N. And basically that means just finding the IEDs on the ground. So I'd go in the compound first or I'd be looking up the pathway or whatever and, yeah.
Arguably the most dangerous job you could have.
Well, yeah, you're either going to get pinged by one of their marksmen or going to get blown up, aren't you? So you've got to be on your game.
Is there a certain mindset? No, I presume not every soldier would want that job.
No, I don't think so, but I actually opted for it in Northern Ireland. I was confident. I'm confident in my abilities. Mm. And I'd rather me finding the IDs than a bloke up the front who's a bit scared, you know what I mean?
So when you first land in Afghanistan, mm. how quickly are you sent into the front line or duty to actually start completing your role?
Within 2 weeks, from Bastion or Kandahar, wherever you land, within 2 weeks to your FOB, which is, the FOB is your forward operating base. And then in between your FOBs, you've got PBs, your patrol bases, and that is the front line. That is engaging with the enemy. I remember I was there at the FOB and within 2 days we were being IDF'd, which stands for indirect fire. So they were mortaring us and, yeah, it was a bit high.
You were 5 months into your first tour of Afghanistan with the Rifles.
That's correct,
in
yes.
In August 2009, and you were leading a patrol up an isolated alleyway in Upper Sanguine Valley. Can you take the story from there?
It wasn't actually me leading. I was acting as a 2IC, making sure the fella in front, he was a lovely fella. His name was Jonathan Young. He was 19 years old. And unfortunately, on that day, he was killed. He hadn't been out in Afghanistan that long. And he was doing my job, which from a different regiment, I haven't got any command over him, but I was just supposed to be watching over him. And it was just hell on earth, really. Do you know what I mean? There was a contact and then there was an IED and that IED was tripped by Jonathan, unfortunately, and he was killed outright. And I managed to get to his body and cover fire, la, 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 la. But the secondary device, which was set off by QRF, which stands for Quick Reaction Force, was set off by Paul McAleese. Now, Sergeant Paul McAleese was my platoon sergeant. His father was Johnny McAleese. Unfortunately, they both passed within 12 months of each other. Johnny McAleese was the first bloke on the Iranian embassy in the 80s, the SASREG. It was an honour to serve with McAleese. And McAleese tripped the device that I was trying desperately not to be near. And he was literally blown in half. And
what's your first instinct?
Well, at that point, it was two devices. The first device that had done Jonathan had ripped through me as well. Then there was a contact. And then McAleese had come out as a platoon sergeant. He tried to assist me, but he had set off a device, a secondary device, which is called a daisy chain. And that set off. You just can't imagine. You've got the heat beaming down on you. Sweat in your eyes. You've got blood and claret all over you. You know, you're gashing out of blood. You're losing blood yourself. And then you can hear your mucker, your oppo down the road screaming, do you know what I mean? And it's just carnage. And then you're sort of losing blood and then the thing to do is just get back. So
almost surreal.
It's a bit of a mad moment, yeah. That's why I don't like Sylvester Stallone, because Rambo ain't real, is it? I never stood up again.
What was your situation then when the second blast occurred?
I think because the first IED ripped through my arm at that point, the second one, McAleese coming on my flank and set the device off, they literally just cut him straight off. You know what I mean? He survived for about an hour afterwards until they got him on the bird, otherwise the Merc, whatever. That ripped through my face and my eyes. Shrapnel cutting through my cheek, part of my nose. I'm an handsome fella now, so make sure you get a good look at me, girls. And it enlodged through the right eye and then into the brain itself. But they tell me with passion and whatever, you know what I mean, that I managed to crawl myself on my left arm behind the behind where the lads were positioned, where they unfortunately scooped me up in a dumper to protect me, what was left of me.
So you still had a little bit of survival instinct there?
That's what they tell me, yeah. So it's just training, I think. It's not me, it's training, isn't it? It's drilled into you, isn't it? You know, IED or grenade or something goes off, you get down, you scramble, don't you? You try to find, so.
Everything post this explosion, I presume, is a blur. You were in a coma for quite a while after.
Yeah, it was quite a tidy little sleep. And then I wake up and then
I'm 3 weeks later.
3 weeks later, you see. And then I wake up and then that was 2010. Yeah, Christmas 2000. I remember Christmas 2010 because the nuts girls come up to the military ward, which I thought was the right result, you know what I mean? And then going into 2010, within 7 months or whatever it was, I was doing my first London Marathon, blind. Then I decided to climb Kilimanjaro. This is all raising money for military charities. And then
was there a point, though, after you'd woken up from your coma where obviously you'd have been suffering from serious depression, but was there then a point where you thought, right, I've got to make the best of what I have got now?
Well, it was actually down to the reason why I'm up here on the Wirral. You've got a legendary blinded soldier, war-blinded soldier here in Liverpool. And I've only ever met him twice in the 9 years that I've been blind. We're part of the same organisation. And the man to me is my hero. People can have heroes all over the world, you know what I mean? But Craig Lundberg, if he does listen, the man's a legend. He lost his sight in Iraq. And I'd woken up and I'd gone past that point where I've been trying to flick the lamp on and off, and it's frustration because like, I could feel the tears running down my face, and it took me weeks to touch my hand, you know, to my face and that. And it's, you know what I mean? Because now I'm blind. It's a realisation, isn't it? When you touch, it's accepting, isn't it? So, and then this Scouse fella come up to me bed, and he's like, I didn't understand a word he said, you know what I mean? He's more froth and spit at the corner of his mouth than anything else. But you know what, he inspired me. He said, I'm climbing Kilimanjaro. And Craig's completely blind himself, and he's gone on to have babies, and he's doing really well here in Liverpool, and he's done blind football. And I've got a lot of respect for Craig. He just put something back in me. He said, just get a grip of yourself, mate, you know what I mean? Come on, it's not the end of the world. And from that, I just thought, right, if a bloody Scouse can do it, then, you know what I mean? I'm from London. And then we've had that little bit of banter ever since, and he just inspired me. And, you know, I owe so much to Craig. I really, really do. And I owe so much to Liverpool, just, you know what I mean? So
so you thought, it sort of felt like you weren't in your own boat there. You felt like there was others around you in a similar situation, encouraging you, inspiring you to do a bit more.
Well, I was down in Birmingham. Craig heard about me through the grapevine, through the charity maybe, and he didn't want me to go through what maybe he'd gone through, you know? And he went off and climbed Kilimanjaro, and I thought, well, if you can do it, I can do it. So I did that, and then the nurse who was taking care of me, I ended up marrying her, and we had a baby together.
You say I climbed Kilimanjaro like it's just an easy feat to do. What did you have to go through to get yourself prepared as a blind man who'd been in your situation to climb Kilimanjaro?
Well, you got to look at it like this. I piled the weight right on. I went from being 16 stone, you know, nice, solid weight, you know, nice six pack, all that old jazz, you know, real, real fit fella out in Afghanistan, to no muscle at all, being in the coma. And then I thought, well, what's the point training? Do you know what I mean? Because I come out of it and I was on all these steroids and all this different medication, and I wanted to be with the fellas. You know, we're down the pub, we was eating pork pies and McDonald's and Domino's, and the weight just piled on. And my weight piled from 16 stone to 22 and a bit stone. And I was a big fella, like, and I think, you know, yeah, I just thought, you know, I've got to do something. And that's when I started doing the marathons, and I did a marathon over 20 stone. I climbed Kilimanjaro over 20 stone, and I just, yeah. But until I got off the medication, the weight just wouldn't come off because I was too busy having parties as well.
You set yourself this incredible series of tasks. Just to go back to the service element as well, obviously you have been awarded the George Medal. I mean, you must be very proud of that. What said to you about that award and you know, why you were so deserving of it?
I don't see it's me as an individual that's deserving, because we're a team, aren't we? We're an army, we're a regiment, battalion, company, platoon, whatever section. You know what I mean? It's not just down to one individual. You know, I can't be, I'm maybe the individual recipient of that medal, but that comes down to the good platoon commander. Bless his soul, you know, Sergeant Paul McAleese, who never made it back that day. Jonathan Young, who I served with out there. You know, we're a team. It's just me. It's a constant reminder. You know what I mean? I don't wear my medals very often. You know, sometimes I wear them at the Suntef, sometimes I won't. Because it's a constant, I don't need to be reminded of the past. You know what I mean? I keep their memories in my heart and in my head.
It was for all of you and the work you were doing that day. Right, you're doing some unbelievable stuff. You're not just stopping at Kilimanjaro and a few marathons, are you? So where's this taking you on to now? What is it you're hoping to try and achieve, Paul?
Well, since losing my sight when I was 20, I've done so much. You know, it's unbelievable. I've had a number 2 record with the Invictus Choir, Flesh and Blood, which was 2016, 2015. I was at the Festival of Remembrance as the second war blinded at the Royal Albert Hall in front of the Royal Family reading my citation. 2014, I closed the, with David Dimbleby reading my poetry, closing the parade there for the Remembrance Parade. So it's not just the physical aspect. I'm trying to champion in every part of my life. You know, just because I'm blind doesn't make me any different to who I was. There's just a few little more obstacles in the way, and it's frustrating. But you know, I can be as good as I want to be, and I can still be that fella I was in the army and achieving. It's just that I have to do it in a different way, which is quite frustrating. So I've done 200K walks in 24 hours, one in Sheffield, one in London to Brighton. Walked 100K across Norway, which is for the Heroes of Telemark. Marathons, triathlons, oh God. What else did I do? Oh yeah, I cycled from Edinburgh Castle to Horse Guard Parade 500 miles. 5 days on a tandem, parachute jumps, you name it. Half marathons, 10Ks, 5Ks, whatever. But the, I do a little bit of blind boxing. I really enjoy that, getting in there and just having a little bit of a scrap with somebody who puts a blindfold on, because it's good fun, do you know what I mean? As long as me oppo in the ring doesn't go too mental, do you know what I mean? It's about having fun. That's all I'm doing it for, you know what I mean? I'm in there just saying, you know, I'd like to give that a go. Let's have a go. So that's why I do that. And I'm now in training. I'm going away next week for real hardcore training, which will be my last week of training for something called the DW. Now, the DW is Devizes to Westminster in a kayak, and I'll be the first blinky, so I'll be the first British war blinded and the first blind man to do 125 miles in a kayak.
It's quite a challenge. You're not someone who spent your life in a kayak.
I don't think so. You know, when I get in it, it's sort of like the front end goes up, you know what I mean?
You're doing all this all the time to raise money for charity as well, aren't you?
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
And the main charity is what, Help for Heroes?
This kayaking one will be for Help for Heroes, and then I'm going to have a week off, go to Tenerife, I think. Just rest and recoup, and then I want to look at training for an Ironman, to be the first war-blinded to do that. It's all about smashing, isn't it? It's all about making legacy and being put in the history books. And then after that, you know, I've got a bucket list. I'd like, my baby would be to do Everest, to be the first British war blinded to climb Everest, and then there's the South Pole and North Pole Challenge, and then swim in the English Channel. But we'll see. I'm only 29.
Have you made tentative inquiries about Everest? Is that something that could happen?
Listen, if that old boy, what's his name, Sir Reynold Fiennes, can do it after heart attack, then I'm Paul Jacobs. I can do anything I want.
Are some people amazed by your level of ambition, your mindset, given what you've been through? Do you find that sometimes when you're talking to people who've not met you before?
I don't really talk about it, but if people are inspired, then that's a good thing, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? But
do you want to use yourself to inspire others?
Absolutely. I do public speaking. I've got a little place over in the Wirral, Peel Hay, so I wanted a business, and I've got a business. The Peel Hay, they do afternoon teas, and it's a hotel. And get yourself over there, folks, and you get to meet me. That cost you an extra $5, though. I'm from London.
You can meet Paul Jacobs.
But being blind, you know what I mean? Everyone just gives me a serviette now instead of a fiver or Monopoly money. You know what I mean? I just get mugged off. I like inspiring for the next generation, because if there's a challenge out there and somebody's already done it, then I'm sort of sets a seed in my head. I'm thinking, could I possibly do that? And how could I do that as the first blind man? And it is all about legacy, isn't it?
As Craig Lundberg has helped you, do you feel it's only right that you help other military personnel who perhaps have been put in similar situations?
It's not even military personnel. It's
it's just anyone, is it?
It's anyone. For example, what was his name? Harris Jones. Gold medal from... Where is he from? He's Toxteth. There we go. Thank you very much. That's my assistant talking in the corner. Michael Jackson's has got bubbles. I've got Barbara. and I bumped into him in Super Trucks, and he started talking. He says, like, you know, and... I inspired him to go away and think about how he could train disabled people. And we're now training. I started training with him last night, and he's a nice fella, and I've got a lot of time for him, and we'll see where the training goes. But who knows? It could be karate, Paralympics.
Paralympics, I was going to bring that up. That must be on the agenda as well.
Well, the Invictus Games, I've got to smash something in the Invictus Games and get gold. But I want to do that in 2020, because that's the last Invictus Games.
And where will that be?
London.
That is at London. So that is the target for you now.
Yeah, yeah. By that point, I'll be a Scousney then, Bonner. A Scouse Cockney.
You're Scouse already.
Scousney.
talk to us a little bit about Help for Heroes and the work it does and how important it is in our modern-day society.
Well, Help for Heroes isn't really my charity. The charity that I've really sponsored and raised money for over the 9 years since losing my sight is Blind Veterans UK, formerly St Dunstan's, which was set up in... 1916 for the War Blinded coming back from the trenches by Sir Arthur Pearson. And that was to inspire the fellas that, you know, you've lost your sight, you've still got your hands, you've still got your legs, you've still got your own mind. Get out there and be something, be a part of the community still, you know. And that community has grown and grown and grown. There's thousands of us that are blind veterans or war blinded. There's a centre in North Wales in Colwyn Bay, Llandudno, and there's one on the south coast in Brighton. And it's a remarkable, unique place, because when you go in there, you feel like that blanket's put over you that, yeah, I'm blind, but you feel really safe in there. You know, it's purpose-built for the blind, so you don't feel embarrassed. There's no way you're going to walk into a door or a wall or anything. And, you know, and that's the thing that a lot of people don't realise by being blind, that, for example, you know, me and you could go out down the pub, Steve, and, you know, I've then got to swallow my pride and say, I've got to whisper in your, excuse me, you know, would you assist me to the toilet? Do you know what I mean? There's little things like that. As a fully grown man, 6'2", 17 stone, you know, it's, oh, you know, you've put a glass in front of me, but you haven't told me where the glass is or placed my hand on the glass to pick up my pint. It's silly little things that, like that, that, you know, it's constantly reminding and you're constantly thinking about telling that person. So,
Paul, you do some remarkable work. Your story's incredible. And thank you very much indeed for your company today.
Thank you. And thank you to the people of the Wirral. Thank you to the people of Liverpool. You know, you've embraced me. You've taken me into your heart. And thank you very much to Barbara and family.
Absolutely. I expect Everest to be done. I expect an Invictus Gold as well.
Don't expect too much.
Paul Jacobs there. What a story.